I'm Jennifer Jacobs.
And I'm Mark Halperin. With all due respect to the nation's fact checkers, make sure you get this one exactly right.
I don't throw babies out, believe me. I love babies.
On our event schedule tonight, the Iran tape backstroke and the email server balance beam. But first, we've got the gold medal event. Donald Trump and Mike Pence are taking the torch to Green Bay, Wisconsin tonight for an evening rally. But you won't see any Badger State political gold medalists there. Governor Scott Walker, Speaker of the House Paul Ryan, and Senator Ron Johnson, who's up for re-election, all plan to skip the event because they all have proverbial prior engagements. The National Party chairman, Wisconsin's Reince Priebus, is also not planning to attend, although he is home in the state today. Priebus does intend to accompany Trump to a series of finance events over the weekend, however, so he is not avoiding his nominee. If you are a Republican who's been in panic mode over Trump's bad week, there is some mildly good news today. Trump appears to be trying to make a mid-course correction. Listen, for instance, to what he had to say in Des Moines, Iowa, at a rally this afternoon, where he got back on track criticizing Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton.
So I wrote up some little points today, and it concerns her. It concerns President Obama, who is doing a terrible job, terrible job. You look at what's going on. You look at what's going on in our country, and you see what's happening. But I thought I'd discuss this because we know Hillary. I know Hillary, and it's interesting. Did it this morning. Unstable, Hillary Clinton lacks the judgment, temperament, and moral character to lead this country. I was the first one, I believe, to use the word unfit in referring to her. Now they pick it up and they use it on me. I always thought that I was extremely fit. In fact, all of my life I've been told, you have the greatest temperament because you go through pressure, you have to be able to handle pressure. She cannot handle pressure.
So there's a man trying to stay on track. Today also brought an uncharacteristic admission of error by the candidate, some sharp press releases criticizing Hillary Clinton. And during tonight's rally in Wisconsin, Trump is expected to, for real, endorse Paul Ryan ahead of the speaker's Tuesday primary. Jennifer Jacobs is with us tonight. We thank her for sitting in for John. Second, I want to ask you, what is all of this a sign of, and what could it lead to for the Trump campaign?
Well, Donald Trump knows how to read a poll, right? So he knows that Paul Ryan is going to win, and win by a lot. So if when Ryan wins, if Trump had no hand in it, that reflects poorly on Donald Trump. I had one GOP strategist say today that if he really does endorse Paul Ryan tonight, like we think he's going to, that the sound of him swallowing his pride is going to be like the sound of guzzling at a college beer bong party.
Not sure what that exactly sounds like, but does his endorsement of Ryan make it seem like it never happened at all? In other words, is there any residue of this that will hurt the Trump campaign?
Well, it's still embarrassing that Paul Ryan is not going to be there. That sends a signal that Paul Ryan doesn't want to be seen next to the GOP nominee, much less being photographed with him. So there still is that sting there. But I know that Republicans will appreciate the fact if Trump does this. It freshens up that feeling that Republicans had just 2 weeks ago after the convention when everyone came out of Cleveland with locked arms.
Yeah.
And there are some Republicans who feel like that was very much squandered.
They left Cleveland as united as a Republican Party with Donald Trump as a nominee could be. It was one of the achievements of Cleveland. And the Ted Cruz thing helped Trump in a way, for sure. I think that, not that long ago, like a day and a half, people were thinking the party was about to come crashing down. Tonight's event, I think, despite the absence of all those people, if he endorses, I think they're somewhat back on track. And they have survived this week without mass defections of any sort. They've lost a handful of people, both some electeds and some not. I think that clearly a lot went on today with the Trump campaign to get him to go out and read that statement. And as you suggested, clearly nothing is going to be as bracing for him as a series of polls and national polls and state polls showing he's behind.
Remember that also that these two candidates, Mike Pence and Donald Trump, squander the two sides of the party. So when you've got Trump, you know, talking about Paul Ryan and saying, "Nah, I'm hesitant. I'm not sure whether I can support him." When he even mentioned Paul Ryan's name at one of his rallies in Florida this week, there were boos from the audience. The audience ate that up. So you've got one candidate. Trump is the candidate of the people. You've got Mike Pence, who's the candidate of the GOP elite. So Trump can speak to the people, and then Pence comes and soothes the nerves of the GOP elite. So Trump can say something about, you know, the Khan family, the parents of that late soldier, and that anti-Muslim undercurrent that might have been there resounds with some of the people, and then Pence comes in and soothes the nerves of the elite again.
The bell rang, but I'll just say there is this issue now. Trump does not like to be criticized. If he held out his endorsement from Ryan, maybe that would send a message, don't criticize him. Now I think he does run a little bit of a risk of people saying, as we go on, if he does say more things they don't like of him, of them being critical of him again, and that's a dynamic he does not like. All right, as we said, today Donald Trump did something we don't typically associate with him. He admitted he made an error. We're talking about that fabled, a.k.a. alleged videotape showing the secretly delivered $400 million to Iran by the U.S. government. The delivery itself and allegations of U.S. cash for hostages has been a talking point for Republicans all week. A good opportunity, many strategists said, for Trump to criticize both Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama over foreign policy. But instead, that's not the way the week has gone. Let's get you caught up.
Donald Trump, Iran tape. Here's what happened.
Breaking tonight, the Wall Street Journal just went up with a stunning story.
Late Tuesday, they report $400 million in cash was sent to Iran, coinciding with the release of four hostages. Early Wednesday, Trump pounces. Scandal. Republicans join in. Call it ransom. Fox is on it.
There you've got the hostages landing in Geneva.
Wednesday afternoon, Trump says he saw a tape.
They have a perfect tape.
Tape of the money coming off the plane.
It was a perfect angle. Nice and steady.
Twitter responds, wait, what tape? Late Wednesday night, the Washington Post asks the Trump campaign, do you mean this tape, the B-roll Fox played of the hostages landing in Geneva? Pope Hicks says yes. So there is no tape. But then, late Thursday, Trump says, remember that tape?
You saw that with the airplane coming in, nice plane.
Says the tape that his campaign says doesn't exist was provided by Iran to embarrass us.
Very odd.
The Nets pick it up.
Tonight, tale of a tape.
Surrogates are questioned.
Why is Donald Trump keep bringing this video up?
I can't answer that question, Wolf.
Jeff Lord says, I mean, you know, that B-roll did kind of look like a secret cash drop.
To be perfectly candid, I saw that, and that's what I thought I was seeing.
Friday morning, Trump tweets, okay, it was the hostage plane, not the plane landing in Iran. Exclamation point. All day Friday, it's all over TV.
So, Jim, is it all now cleared up?
No.
All right, so unusual for Trump to tweet a correction. He didn't fall on his sword completely, but he did acknowledge his error. What does that say about where he stands with his campaign, since I suspect this wasn't his idea? And where does this, do you think this leave us with Trump's capacity to limit distraction?
Well, it shows that he's willing to listen to all those influential Republicans who said, listen, take control of the wheel and avoid the cliff. One interesting thing that happened this week at one of his rallies in Florida, he really showed his cards about why he's running for president. He talked about how much he loves it. He admitted that it gets him pumped up. He said it makes him feel 20 years younger. And he talked about how he loves hearing that thunderous chorus from the crowd of them calling his name. And then he kind of corrected himself and caught himself and said, but the real reason I'm running is to make America great. But that gave us some insights into his thinking. And I know there have been some donors who have been reaching out to some of the senior staff. I know it wasn't easy to get hold of some of them this week. They were kind of underground. But some donors have been sending text messages and calling and saying very gently, look, this messiah complex thing he's got going on is not helping us. He can't look like he's infallible. And so this shows that he can correct a mistake and move on quickly.
And there was no benefit to talking about this non-existent tape. It's just video. There's just no benefit to it. And I will say, people are, in the current narrative, based on the polls, based on his poor performance, based on his attacking the cons for day after day, people are underestimating the degree to which this guy is competitive and does not like to be embarrassed. And this was an embarrassing week for him. So the tweet was a way to move that narrative away. And the reality is, the press is open to the narrative now of Trump fixing things. Today were some baby steps, and he's still got a world to hurt with the polls and other issues. But baby steps to show that he can actually do things to turn the page.
It is one quick note, though. He did not say he was mistaken. He didn't say, I'm wrong.
Right.
He very carefully just said, he explained which plane he was talking about. But it was a very interesting way of avoiding accountability.
Call it a baby step. Yes. Yeah. All right. Coming up, we got binders full of men after these words from our sponsors. We'll be right back. Auga, BAFO alert. Today, the monthly jobs report showed an increase of 255,000 new jobs. That's higher than even bullish economists expected. The unemployment rate stayed even at 4.9%. On the official Halperin Bafometer, shows that 4 out of 5 possible BAFOs, that's a lot of BAFOs. Trump campaign, of course, is painting this in a different way. A statement from senior policy advisor Stephen Miller points out the recent 1.2 growth rate statistics and said the country is, quote, in the middle of the single worst recovery since the Great Depression. But given the last few months of job data, punctuated with the exclamation point of today's report, Jennifer, the question I have is, can Hillary Clinton go now from emphasizing, as she has been, there's more work to do, people are still hurting, to more of a happy days are here again message?
Yeah, she can. And she can more easily refute Trump if he says that the Obama economy is bad. Although with the Trump campaign, they are so good at avoiding bad news and spinning things. They've got this eternal sunshine thing going on. So like Stephen Miller was arguing there, they can talk about that GDP report and the slow growth of the economy. They can also go back and talk about the underemployment rate, those people who are only working part-time when they should be working full-time, and talk about that. That just ticked up a teensy-weensy little bit.
Yeah.
So there are ways that they can refute this and come back at Hillary Clinton, but it definitely makes it harder for him to insult the Obama economy.
The growth rates are not great, and people's long-term anxiety is still high, and the wrong track number, driven a lot by the economy, is still high, and I suspect will still be high by election day. This does give her, though, a big talking point. There's nothing bigger than the jobs number for people and the notion that wages may be ticking up a little bit. I do think, I've said for a while, for all the superficiality of this race, for all the personality-driven aspects of it, I still think if either of these candidates can convince people that they've got an ideas for making the economy better, they'll have a huge leg up in the race. And so I don't think it's enough for Donald Trump to be negative about the economy. I don't think it's enough for Hillary Clinton to become a little more bullish. They have to have some actual ideas.
But listen, who on the Trump side is talking about jobs? I mean, Donald Trump has made this race a referendum on his character, on his personality.
Right.
I mean, his whole playbook is being controversial.
Yeah. The one thing I will say as we close this thing is this is a huge thing for the Clinton campaign. They want some optimistic things to talk about. They'd like her to be more optimistic and more optimistic about the president's record. This makes it easier. All right. On the economy, today the Trump campaign announced an economic advisory council consisting of 13 people. You can't spell advisory without a Y, as in Y chromosome, which it turns out can be found in every single member of Trump's council. Yes, ahead of his planned economic speech on Monday in Detroit, Trump unveiled a diverse roster of all men, including Colony Capital founder and RNC speaker Tom Barrack, Vector Group topper Howard Lorber, U.S.-China trade relations expert Peter Navarro, and the chief economist at the Heritage Foundation, cable TV talking head Stephen Moore. On Bloomberg TV today, Moore said that a broader economic advisory list does include some women. We were unable to locate that list. Kind of incredible in this day and age they put out a list of advisors of all men. But leaving that aside, what does the ideological makeup and background of this team say about Trump's economic orientation?
Yeah, it's an interesting group of people. All of them are very successful in business or in their field. Not all of them are yes men. Some of them have been very critical of Donald Trump. For example, Stephen Moore has been critical of Trump for calling for high tariffs for China, and he called the Trump's Judge Curiel comments indefensible. You've got Dan DiMicco, who used to be Trump's trade advisor, who has praised NAFTA in the past, so he's not necessarily exactly on line with Donald Trump. DiMicco doesn't think that free trade is a bad thing, but he really stresses keeping manufacturing in the United States. A lot of these guys are friends of Trump's, donors of Trump's, like, for example, Tom Barrack. They did real estate deals together in the 1980s. Barrack was one of the early supporters of the Trump Super PAC. But, you know, he has an interesting philosophical outlook. He, in an interview with our Bloomberg reporters, talked about how Hillary Clinton is a very competent person and would be a very competent president. Yep. And he also said, listen, I'm liberal on social issues. I'm kind of a lame Republican. So you've got an interesting mix of ideological, you know, philosophies from these guys.
To me, the most striking thing is only one guy with an academic background. It's basically people in the private sector, a lot of people in finance and services who are Trump types. They're strong-willed, business people with little or no government experience who want to make America great again and who believe the private sector needs to be unshackled. I think it's actually the gender lack of diversity notwithstanding, it's actually a good signal to the public of the kind of people I think Trump would bring into the government if he won. People who don't know how government works don't come in to try to change things like Trump himself.
Right.
All right, move over strong bad. It's time for Hillary Clinton's emails. Secretary Clinton gave a talk today at the National Association of Black Journalists and the National Association of Hispanic Journalists. That was in Washington, D.C., where the two groups convened. She spoke briefly and then took a few questions from some of the journalists there, including NBC News' Kristen Welker. She asked about Clinton's comment over the weekend to Chris Wallace at Fox, suggesting that the FBI Director James Comey had vouched for her truthiness regarding her email practices. That comment earned her some bad reviews, including the Washington Post giving her its maximum number of Pinocchios for lack of honesty and accuracy. She got other rebukes as well. So today, Clinton was given a chance to clarify and maybe clean up what she'd said over the weekend to, when Kristen Welker asked the follow-up. So obviously, she took the opportunity.
Well, I may have short-circuited it, and for that, I will try to clarify, because I think Chris Wallace and I were probably talking past each other. Because, of course, he could only talk to what I had told the FBI, and I appreciated that. Now, I have acknowledged repeatedly that using two email accounts was a mistake, and I take responsibility for that. But I do think, having him say that my answers to the FBI were truthful, and then I should quickly add, what I said was consistent with what I had said publicly, and that's really sort of, in my view, trying to tie both ends together.
Ooh, that didn't do much to clarify. Look, she continues to be purposely not addressing some of the tougher things Comey said. She's clinging to the exculpatory stuff that Comey said and overstating that and not dealing with some of the criticisms and the question. Again today, failed to address the question of what she said in public, not what she said to the FBI. So the question is, why is she leaving herself open to dragging this out more? Why not just give a more definitive answer?
Well, that was certainly some word soup. But the Democrats can argue, listen, anything, maybe she has said a couple things that were not exactly accurate, but they can argue that this week that Trump has just completely stepped on that opportunity to come at her after anything that she says pales in comparison to what the week that Trump has had, where he said, not joking, that he thought that baby was annoying and talking about anyone who's sexually harassed should just switch careers and not endorsing Paul Ryan and saying that John McCain hasn't been good to the veterans and Americans should pull their money out of 401ks. I mean, it goes on and on. So the Democrats
she's counting on what the Clintons often count on, which is the press basically getting tired of plowing the same ground, that the public will lose interest in it. And they continue to believe that saying, I'm sorry, I made a mistake, I shouldn't have done it, is enough. I still think she's not addressed the question of what she thinks she did wrong. And that relates to the question of Comey's criticism. And it's not clear to me if people are going to keep asking her about it. But today's answer, we'll see if the Post trots out Pinocchio again. But today's answer was more of the same of claiming things about what Comey said that he didn't say, particularly because he didn't address her public statements, which is our bigger concern, I think, for the public than what she might have told the FBI behind closed doors. All right, coming up, Donald Trump's big Wisconsin rally and what it means for your weekend plans. Traffic and weather together right after this. And the big brain strategist now, joining us now from our Washington, D.C. Bureau, Ed Rogers, Republican. He's worked in the Office of Political Affairs for President Reagan, is now a contributor to the Washington Post. And from Los Angeles, Democratic strategist Bill Carrick, worked with Senator Ted Kennedy, Dianne Feinstein, Chuck Schumer, and many, many, many more. Gentlemen, thank you for joining us.
Bill, good to be here.
Bill, start with you. If Hillary Clinton calls you tonight and says, I know I've had a great week, Trump's had a horrible week, but what should I be worried about? What would you tell her?
Well, I think the big thing they're going to have to worry about is Trump's chances of getting a rebound here are probably pretty low between now and Labor Day. They have to be ready for the debates. I mean, that's the 270 electoral college votes. There's 270 minutes of debates, so they just have to be. They have to be ready for that because that's going to be Trump's only chance to get back in this game.
Ed, you're voting for Trump, right?
No,
you're not. Who are you voting for?
I'm not voting for Trump. I'm a non-Trump supporter. I'm a good Republican. I'm certainly not going to vote for Hillary. Trump hadn't met me halfway yet.
So you might vote for Trump is what you're saying.
Well, the possibilities are becoming less likely and the scenarios are more remote.
Yeah.
But I'm not never Trump.
If
something could happen.
What? Give me one example. If he called you tonight and said, Ed, I saw you on With All Due Respect. I really want your vote. Tell me what I need to do. What would you tell him?
You need to be sane and mute for a while. Let us all rest and reflect.
What about you, Bill? What would you tell him?
Well, I agree with Ed. The biggest thing, you know, there's a talk show host out here, Doug McIntyre, has a great phrase for Trump's malady. He says he has political Tourette's. He just got to shut up. I mean, these things that he just throws out there every other day that cause enormous distraction and trouble, if he doesn't figure out how to stop that, he's going to really get clobbered.
In that regard, if he were just quiet and the economy became the issue and something happened in the national security realm and Hillary's inability, she boxed herself in. She can't ring the alarm about the economy. She's bought in to Obama, all things Obama, national security and economically. She can't ring the alarm. Trump could be standing there where people say, things couldn't get any worse. Let's give this guy a chance. If he would just be quiet, that could happen. I'm not sure it's desirable, but it could happen.
Do you guys believe the polls?
I'm not sure it's possible. The other problem is it's probably not possible.
I'll concede that. It doesn't look that way.
Okay, let me ask you both. Do you guys believe the polls? If the election were tomorrow, who do you think would win?
Hillary.
Hillary, definitely. I think this is
The story of 2016. Go ahead, Bill. Sorry.
This is one case where the national polls are probably more useful in terms of information than some of these state polls. And I think the trend nationally is pretty clear. And you begin to see it filter down when you start having polls with Hillary ahead in Georgia and Arizona. This is a national race, and it's hers right now.
All right.
The story of 2016 so far, I hope it'll be in Mark Halperin's next book, but the 2016 story of the polls, if the polls have been right, the polls hadn't been long. I went around for a year in 2015 saying, everybody, ignore the polls. Trump can't win.
Right.
You
They've
know,
been
well,
pretty accurate. All right, guys, we're going to talk about down ballot races when we come back with Bill Carrick and Ed Rogers right after this. Jacobs and I back here with Republican strategist Ed Rollins in D.C., Bill Carrick, Democrat out in California. So, guys, it seems clear there's going to be some more Republicans who, based on their sense of what's right and maybe the politics, want to distance themselves more from Donald Trump. We've seen a couple people do that already. Ed Rogers, you first. If you had a client running for House or Senate who said, I want a more distance from Trump, I'm not comfortable running in harness with him, what's the best way to do that and message that?
Yeah, everybody's sort of struggling with what the right decoupling formula is from Trump. And obviously it depends on the state where you're running. It's different in Arizona than it is in Pennsylvania, Ohio, et cetera. But everybody's dealing with that right now. But nobody wants to have a rupture with the core of the Trump supporter because they're the core Republican. They're the first 35% of any Republican's vote are Trump supporters. So there is no easy formula. There's no easy way to do it. But I think this week you did get into an era where it is sort of every man for himself in a good way for Republicans. There's no longer any pressure to be for Trump. There's pressure to figure out how to accommodate the reality of Trump. But everybody's looking, like I said, for that decoupling formula.
Bill, if you're Ted Strickland in Ohio or Maggie Hassan in New Hampshire, what's the best way to try to tie your Republican opponent to Trump?
Well, I think you're going to have to do it on, you know, the big picture issues, the economy and national security. That's obvious. But I think I think you could, as a Democrat, you could get carried away with this idea of linking Trump to your opponent. I think, you know, in some cases, that's going to do all the damage it's going to do just organically. And pushing that as an issue in the campaign, using it in your paid communications, that kind of thing, that might not be the smartest move to make.
Bill, the idea that Donald Trump is a drag on the ticket for some people in the swing states, which state do you think is that effect happening the most pronounced?
Well, I think you're going to, you know, the battleground states are going to have the ones where there is a contested Senate race and a very contested campaign at the presidential level. So Ohio and Pennsylvania, I think that's really a big deal in both those places because the campaign is going to be so present, probably in New Hampshire as well. I think in Illinois, just because it's such a strong blue state, it'll be a real drag on Mark Kirk.
You agree with that, Ed?
Yeah, Mark Kirk got a headwind regardless. Ron Johnson in Wisconsin has a headwind. Probably less severe Illinois. But, you know, the bullseye here is for Trump and for the Republican Senate is going to mostly be Pennsylvania and Ohio. And that's going to be the toughest place to negotiate the presence of Trump versus a must-win Senate race.
Ed, there seems to be no doubt. Go ahead, Bill.
Well, I was just going to say that the one thing about Pennsylvania and Ohio are now going to be all hands on board for Trump because Virginia and North Carolina are so bad. Yeah. I mean, he's just losing in places that are going to make the pressure more intense on Pennsylvania and Ohio.
Yeah. Ed, it seems like Donald Trump is doing a very good job of uniting the Democratic Party. Why is Hillary Clinton not providing that same service to the Republicans right now, or so it seems to me?
Well, she hasn't broken through in a while. She's a good uniter for Republicans, but Trump seems to be stepping on any news that would remind us of the very things we'd like the least about Hillary and remind the broader electorate, as a matter of fact. And if this race is about Trump, he loses. If this race is about Hillary, she loses. And can Trump let the bad economy take over? Can he let Hillary be front and center? Can he just be neutral for a while and see what happens? So far, he cannot.
You know, the other thing about... You know,
go ahead, Bill.
Good.
The one thing about Hillary, when, you know, as voters start moving towards her, and we see that the head-to-head is moving faster than the attributes below that, voters will reconcile their support for her as a vote with their feelings about her. They just will. They will not. There will not continue to be this tension between saying you're going to vote for her and having negative feelings about her. They will reconcile, and it will become positive feelings and a vote for her.
Bill, between summer.
Yeah, I saw one of the network. As you say, I saw one of the network polls today, where she has some healthy lead in the head-to-head. Yet by 4 or 5 points, people trust him to deal more effectively with the economy than they do her.
Right.
I think Bill's right. Those two things will reconcile. But surely the Trump people notice that. And if they got any sense at all, they'll try to exploit it.
Guys, less than a minute to go. Let me ask Bill first. Summer vacation, the Olympics. Is it possible for Trump to make up ground in August? Or does he have to wait till after Labor Day to have any meaningful closing of the gap?
I think it's very hard to do. I really do. And she's got an advantage in paid media. She's going to have more ads on the air in the battleground states. So you add that into it. If somebody can figure out the scheduling process in the Trump campaign, we may have the secret to the problem because they continue to go to odd places, which doesn't help them either. I think it's very, very tough for them to make up any ground between now and Labor Day.
Ed, if there was one state where Trump could make up ground that would harden Republicans besides Ohio, what would it be?
Maybe New Hampshire.
Yeah, symbolically
like Bill said,
important.
Virginia, North Carolina. If he had some sort of strong heartbeat there, I think that would be a good sign.
Okay. Bill Carrick in California, Ed Rogers in D.C. Guys, thank you both for coming in. Enjoy your weekend. Coming up, a look at what the Clinton campaign seems to be doing to capitalize on Trump's bad week. Talk to two of our colleagues. If you're watching us in Washington, D.C., you can listen to us on the radio always at Bloomberg 99.1 FM. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Joining us now, Washington Post political correspondent Ann Gearan, and here with us in the studio off of Fifth Avenue, NBC News correspondent Katy, who covers the Trump campaign. And you first, let me just ask you, as the Clinton campaign obviously had a happy week, what's on their to-do list now for the month of August?
Well, beyond going on vacation, which we expect Hillary Clinton to do the latter part of the month, really to try to stay out of the way of Donald Trump as much as possible if what he's going to do is do damage to himself. They really hope that the last week or so is a trajectory that they can hold on to, where Republicans are peeling off from Trump and either endorsing her or saying they can't support him. Either of those things, the Clinton campaign will take, just sort of, you know, continuing to get her jobs message out and not trying to make any big moves of her own. That'll be what they do for the rest of the month.
Do we know she's going to the Hamptons? Is that where vacation will be?
Martha's Vineyard is the most likely location. There's some fundraisers there.
Handoff from the Obamas.
Katy, something like that, yeah.
Katy Turr, within the campaign today, Jason Miller, the communications director, did a radio interview where he basically said, we had a pretty good week in some ways. Is there panic and concern that they need to have a dramatic change in the way the campaign's going, or just grind it out with battleground state rallies and maybe Trump being a little more disciplined?
I'm not hearing panic within the campaign. I think that Donald Trump has gone from controversy to controversy, so this is not an unusual position for this campaign to be in. They've sort of become a little bit used to it. They are trying to spin that this has been a bad week for Hillary Clinton. Jason Miller said the same thing to me repeatedly this week. But the reality is Donald Trump is down in a lot of battleground state polls. You guys know this. I mean, significantly down in places like Pennsylvania, 15 points in New Hampshire. That's a big number. And he's going into Wisconsin tonight, and he's got problems in Wisconsin. So the campaign may not want to say that anything's wrong behind the scenes, but you're seeing that there is a course correction in Donald Trump's own actions. This morning, tweeting that he was actually looking at video of the American detainees leaving a plane in Switzerland. And then today trying to explain the baby. And now, from our reporting, endorsing Paul Ryan tonight. Expected to, at least. It's Donald Trump. You have to be careful with how you cage it, because he can always change his mind. But there, it does seem to be an attempt towards a course correction and an acknowledgement that things are not going well.
And do you have any thoughts on the Gary Johnson effect? When you talk to voters, especially independents, are you hearing anything about Gary Johnson in any of her crowds? Or do you think he'll have any effect on the race at all?
You do hear his name a little bit. I don't expect him to have a very large effect. Also hear the Green Party candidate's name a little bit as a protest vote, Jill Stein as a protest vote against Hillary. Again, not likely to have a very large effect.
Who within the Trump campaign right now, to the extent there are camps, is there division about how to proceed?
You know, there's less, two-camp atmosphere than there was when Corey Lewandowski was there. Corey Lewandowski, from what I'm hearing, does still try to pull some strings behind the scenes. The rivalry between him and Manafort is ongoing, and there's a bit of revenge politics going on there. But Manafort has been systematically trying to purge the campaign of everybody that was loyal to Lewandowski. There's not a, from the conversations that I've had at least, in a sense that this is us versus them within the campaign. It's an idea that it's us versus everybody else.
Is that coup pretty complete at this point? Is there any Corey loyalists still in there
working for Corey? There's a couple strongholds there. For the most part, it does seem like the coup is
Manafort won.
Yeah, Manafort won. But then again,
Donald Trump talks to Corey Lewandowski all the time.
Right.
And then that's the, you know, that's part of the issue that, that some of his aides are talking about, that there is an undercutting going on between Manafort's influence and Corey's desire to maintain the ear of Donald Trump.
And a lot of comments this week about Trump. One piece of good news was the fundraising. Did that get the attention of the folks in Brooklyn?
Yeah, I mean, they are concerned a little less so than they were 6 weeks or so ago. They are concerned about the rally around the candidate aspect that they see happening on the Republican side, where there are Republican donors in the view of the Clinton people, the Republican donors who are sort of holding their nose but giving money anyway. And the Clinton people are somewhat concerned that means that what they had hoped for in there being an ongoing fundraising gap will not materialize. So she had a very, very good month in July, and they are trumpeting that pretty hard.
Yeah, I mean, it should be noted, as impressive as Trump's number was in the grassroots aspect of it, she's in some ways having more success fundraising than incumbent President Barack Obama did, and that's not nothing. I said this yesterday, and I'm sure Donald Trump will think I'm being politically correct, but how could they put out a list of economic advisors of all men? How could that possibly happen?
I don't think they realized what they were doing, and that's part of the issue you have with this campaign. They're not going out and trying to play defense before they get on they get attacked for these sorts of things. It is hard to believe that there's not one economic mind out there that is a female.
It's a big country.
It's a big country. Good portion of the list, too, is Donald Trump's friends, his donors, and other, big business leaders. It's not necessarily an economic team so much as it is people who Donald Trump believes know what they're talking about.
Hope Hicks, Trump's press secretary, told us right before the show they will roll out more names on an ongoing basis, and presumably it will include women. But, and again, it's symbolic, but it's hard to believe at a time when you're trying to appeal to a broader group of voters that you could just...
Look at who's close to Donald Trump. I mean, there's not a lot of females.
Put Ivanka on it.
Well, there's, you know, he has Ivanka.
She's a businesswoman.
Well, Ivanka is one of his closest advisors. Yeah. She's a female. And then there's Hope Hicks. And for the most part, the rest of the top people in Donald Trump's circle are men. I mean, it's a very male-centric world.
Yeah.
And let me ask you, the bus tour this week, I've heard it was pretty grueling. How did she like it? Do you think she had a really good time? Was it successful?
Well, I was on the bus tour at the very back of the motorcade, and people kept asking us, oh, what's it like? You know, are you on the same bus with her? Are you playing cards with her? I was like, wait a minute, let me explain. When the bus goes around, when the motorcade goes around a curve at just the right angle from the back of the motorcade, I can see her bus way up there. She did seem to have a good time at the events. There wasn't a lot of sort of classic bus tour sorts of stuff that went along with it. I mean, they weren't stopping for ice cream and stopping alongside the road to shake hands or anything. In fact, there was really none of that. Only on the last day did she even stop at a restaurant anywhere, and that's where she had a small Q&A session with reporters. Overall, the Clinton campaign believes it was a success in getting out her economic message, the idea that she has a jobs program, a plan to add jobs and promote college education for those who want it in areas of the country that are in their view, particularly susceptible to Trump's economic message, which is sort of blue-collar, white America in Pennsylvania and Ohio. That's where the bus tour was centered. That said, she went to places in those states that had sort of a counter-programming message. She went to advanced manufacturing facilities and talked about revitalizing American manufacturing.
Yep, it was a great made-for-TV bus trip. And Gearan, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Katy, stay with us. We'll be right back with some numbers straight out of Wisconsin right after this. In the spirit of the Olympics, Jennifer Jacob has passed the hosting baton to NBC's Katy Turr, who's joining us now, along with, from Washington, D.C., Ken Goldstein, professor of politics, University of San Francisco, and Bloomberg's designated polling and political advertising guru, and an expert on Wisconsin, where he used to be based. So, Ken, Trump's there tonight with Pence. They're obviously making a push there. That is a state Democrats have consistently won. How realistic is it for Trump to put Wisconsin in play?
Simple answer, not very realistic at all. I think Wisconsin is sometimes that, you know, football with Lucy and Charlie Brown. I see no evidence that Wisconsin's going to be competitive. We don't see any advertising dollars there. It's going to be interesting to see what sort of crowd they draw tonight, because Pence, after the convention, went to Waukesha County. There is no more important county in the country for Republicans in terms of generating votes, and Pence only got 500 people. So I don't see Wisconsin, my former home state, being in play this year.
Yeah, I know Wisconsin went to Ted Cruz during the primaries. Is there any reason to believe that Donald Trump could turn it around there? And if he could, what does he need to do? Does he need to get talk radio on his side? Does he need to get behind forcefully Paul Ryan today, say he does support him? Is that an option? Can he turn it around?
Well, the point you made, Katie, about talk radio is a really important one. In the Milwaukee media market, which is over 40% of the state, conservative talk radio is huge. And different than conservative talk radio in much of the country, conservative talk radio in Milwaukee, in Wisconsin, was anti-Trump during the primaries and has remained anti-Trump. So the number of votes that a Republican would have to generate out of, they're called the WOW counties, they're those counties that that border the city of Milwaukee, a Republican just can't get that unless talk radio is on their side. And I see no evidence that they're going to come on his side in a big megaphone way.
We've talked a lot about the disparity in advertising between Clinton and Trump and the two sides. Clinton is going to buy national time during the Olympics. No indication Trump is. Why buy national at this point when it's not a national election? Why not focus on the battleground states?
It's interesting and something that we may see more of down the line. So Clinton has $32 million bought over the next 3 weeks. Half of that is national, $8 million on national cable news networks, and $8 million on NBC on the Olympics. I think it's a case where it might just have been easier, where it was hard to get inventory, hard to buy battleground state by battleground state if you just wanted the Olympics. So it was easier and perhaps even cheaper for them to just buy national, even if there is a little wastage. The other thing is, I think that it makes it a little bit more attractive for the national media to talk about it if it's a national buy.
Yep. I know in the past you've said that we shouldn't be paying attention to the polls. Is now the time to start paying attention to the polls? Does it matter now in August?
Yes, start paying attention to the polls now. I think, you know, we do see some variance from poll to poll, but there is a, you know, a general picture emerging of a Clinton bounce, and not so much maybe a Clinton bounce, but whatever the opposite of bounce is for Trump. And this race clearly isn't in the 7, 8, 9 percentage point range. And I think that is a meaningful number at this time. And, you know, again, I should stop making predictions this year, but I can't imagine that changing very much before the debates in September.
Without improvement, worst case for Trump, Joel Benenson told me he thought Trump's floor was 40%. We see him in some of these polls below 40. Is it possible that in this polarized country that the Republican nominee, again, worst case, no Trump comeback for him, that he could do worse than 40%?
Well, what's interesting in the polls is all the polls basically agree on their horse race number, but when you look in the internals, they actually have some disagreements. And one of the ways that the polls differ is how loyal Republicans are. And in some of those polls, you see Trump starting to dip below 80, closer to 75 among his support from Republicans. So Republicans are going to vote for the Republican, but if you start to get Republican loyalty dipping below 80 and Hillary Clinton able to be competitive with independents, you could get into that 40 or under range.
Okay. Ken Goldstein, thanks very much. Katy Turt, thank you.
Thank you.
Back out to Fifth Avenue for you. We'll be right back. So we talked about Trump's chances in Wisconsin with Ken Goldstein. What are Trump's chances in Iowa?
Well, yeah, it's definitely a swing state, purple state. It's very difficult to see where it's going to roll. Obviously, they went for Ted Cruz in the caucuses, and Trump maybe didn't do any good for himself today by saying to the crowd in Des Moines, I'm not a big fan of the Iowa caucuses. I'm not sure how well that went over, but
we saw he was there today. At BloombergPolitics.com right now, John McCormick's great piece. is up there about Clinton's spending binge on the Olympics. Emily Chang is next on Bloomberg West. Until Monday, thanks for watching. Sayonara.